Welcome to the Well Woman Show, where we interview women executives, leaders, and entrepreneurs.
And you're listening to the Well Woman Show,
where motivated women achieve fulfillment and well-being.
You're listening to the Well Woman Show.
Take time for myself by coming to things like Well Woman Drinks.
To be accepting of myself no matter what. Step away from judgment as much as possible.
You're listening to the Well Woman Show.
You're going to be in for a good ride. I don't regret anything. Everything I've ever done, I've learned from it, one way or another, good or bad.
Being a little bit selfish for yourself, you know, put your own oxygen mask on first and then give what's left.
I'm a woman. I would prefer to tell my own story. My story, though it's very personal, is universal.
You're listening to the Well Woman Show. And now your host, Giovanna Rossi.
Hi, Giovanna Rossi here, and welcome to another episode of the Well Woman Show. I'm so happy you're here, so thanks for tuning in. Today's topic is reclaiming your power, and hopefully by the end of the show, you'll be inspired to end destructive behavior, begin saying yes and no when you mean it, and fearlessly pursue what's missing from your life. My guest today is Robin Anderson, women's empowerment advocate, author, former teacher, and certified professional life coach. Robin worked for many years as a teacher before realizing her calling to help women realize their potential and inner strength. Today, I'm going to talk to Robin about putting her needs to the side for others, learning to own her ideas when others tried to claim them, and helping women to replace self-doubt with self-love and power. The free giveaway today is Robin's Giving Away Your Power handout. Listeners can download it at wellwomanlife.com/015show. I love this giveaway because it introduces what it means to give away your power, how you're doing it on a daily basis, and it includes a quick activity to take steps to reclaim it. But before we get started, I want to thank our sponsor today, Leafy Greens. You can go to wellwomanlife.com/leafygreens to sign up for a cleanse and get a 10% Well Woman discount. Now for my interview with Robin Anderson. Well, Robin Anderson, welcome to the Well Woman Show. It's so great to have you on the show today.
Thanks, Giovanna. Thanks for the opportunity.
Robin, I want to jump right in and just get some background on you. You are a women's leadership advocate and life coach, but would you give me a short summary of who you are and what your commitment is to women's well-being?
I have been committed to women's well-being, women's networking, women's progress since I was a teenager. I've always been a proponent for young girls and then for women. I've always seen how women put themselves down or don't go for all of the possibilities in their lives. And it's a theme that has traveled through practically my entire life. I now have a framework for working on that with other women, but that's always been a passion in my life. Discover who you are and then just do whatever you need to do to be that person.
Hmm. Okay. And, you know, on the Well Woman Show, we talk about the need for women to put themselves first in order to take care of business, take care of their lives, but also take care of other people. So, could you describe a time in your life when you didn't put yourself first, when you weren't taking care of yourself the way you know now that you need to? And can you describe that?
Sure. When I first got married, my husband had an important job that was paying a whole lot more than my job. And I took that to mean that his needs were much more important than mine. And I sacrificed my things, the things that I wanted to do, my own career plans, to allow him to do his things. And that also has been woven throughout a good chunk of my life. And around the age of, 45 or so, I finally said, enough is enough. I'm not going to disregard the important people in my life, but I'm important too. You know, that you get on an airline and the flight attendants say you need to put on your own oxygen mask before you help other people. Well, it finally started dawning on me that if I wasn't taking care of myself, if I wasn't feeling fulfilled, nobody else was going to do that for me. And then I wouldn't have any reserves to give to other people, my family, friends, other people in my world. And so I decided I was going to make sure I took good care of myself and that I was enjoying my life and not being at the beck and call of every person that I came in contact with.
Yeah, I mean, sacrificing career plans, I think, is a common thing that women do, right? Because of their family, because in your case, your husband made more than you. And so it starts there, but it can expand into every part of your life in terms of, you know, women sacrificing themselves for the needs of other people.
Exactly. Exactly. I think our culture assumes if you are in a relationship with a man, the man's career, the man's whatever comes first. And it's really hard to be counterculture like that.
This really leads into the next question I had for you,
sure.
Which was, how do you think being a woman impacted that time in your life?
How being a woman impacted my life?
Yeah, just the nature of being a woman. How did that impact that time of your life?
Well, my first career was being a teacher. Okay, that's perfectly acceptable for a woman. And, you know, the pay was not as great as being in a profession outside of a helping profession. And so when I joined the business world and then ultimately worked at a university, I could see that it was a man's networking world. Men got higher salaries. Women got the fluffier jobs, not the core business kinds of jobs. And it really irked me. So I did things to get myself on a variety of committees that would give visibility to me. I was often the only female in a group of men. I made sure that my opinion was associated with me and not, as I witnessed many times, stolen by some other male within the group that I was in. And
can you describe that a little bit more?
Sure. I would be sitting in a meeting and I would suggest something and no one jumped up and said, wow, great idea. And then a few minutes later, a man would say almost verbatim what I had said. And people thought it was wonderful. Let's do this. Everybody join in. And I got to the point where I said, wait a minute. Let's just remember, I suggested that as well. I am claiming ownership of that. And I made it a point to make sure that I received credit for the things that I did and not let them get stolen out from under me.
Hmm.
Along the way, I made sure that other women recognized they could do the same thing and they had to do it because no one else was going to stand there and defend them.
Now, Robin, you made some major changes in your life and you are now a life coach and helping other women through these struggles and tough times. When did you know you needed to make that change or become a well woman, so to speak? Like, did you have a moment where it shifted?
I think that the idea began when I was working in corporate America, and I could see women in positions that didn't have as much power as men. And so I really started noticing that. But it never really came to fruition until I worked at a major university and I had an administrative fellowship position with the vice president of the university. That gave me access to a lot of the highest level committees within the university. So those kinds of activities where women were discounted were significantly more glaring. Besides the fact that I was often the only woman in the room at the time. So the inequalities became very apparent. And I got myself into a leadership position at the university where I was on a presidential committee dealing with improving the equality of women at the university. So I became much more strident. I had a channel for expressing the issues directly to the president and senior members of his administration. And that just gave me even more fire to fuel my passion to help women.
Hmm. And what kind of changes were you able to make?
Well, one of the ones that I am most proud of, I started a mentoring program for women. And it's, let me see, it's about 18 years old, and it's still going strong. It's a way for women within the university, faculty and staff, to find someone to help them learn the skills they need to be able to move on to the next job, the next career at the university. That program has made a major impact in many, many women's lives. Mm-hmm. We produced a report, this presidential committee produced a report based on hiring data from the Human Resources Department at the university as to the existence of inequalities by colleges, by staff levels of job function, and so forth. And that was passed along to deans, to other people in power, to make some changes. We put programs in place for female graduate students, particularly in the sciences, where they were often called to be in the lab late at night, and then they'd have to walk home across campus in the dark at the wee hours of the morning. We brought some of these issues to the forefront because we had power and we had the attention of people who could make changes.
Hmm. So you saw that women were being discounted. You were sometimes the only woman in the room. And those kinds of things you were saying really fueled your passion. And you were able to act on that and actually make a difference in women's lives. And you continue to do so. And we'll get into a little bit of your work and your book in a little bit. But I just wanted to continue this conversation about becoming a well woman. Mm-hmm. And that moment when you made that change. And on this show, we do talk about sort of being selfish, right? Which is actually a generous act, if you think about it, because you have to take care of yourself in order to take care of others. So, and I think women have a hard time thinking about that word, like being selfish is somehow wrong.
Well, again, there are so many cultural messages that it's okay to give to others. But if you do something just for yourself, you're somehow taking away from your job. You are, in effect, being selfish. So many of my clients don't call it being selfish, but that inevitably comes out in our conversations. Oh, well, I couldn't do that. What would people think? I couldn't do that. My kids would suffer. There's all kinds of excuses that cloud the issue. Mm. If we don't take care of ourselves, if we don't replenish ourselves, fill our souls, we won't have anything to give anyone else. We will be absolutely dry, empty, and probably very crabby women.
Yeah. And so, Robin, when is the last time you did something truly selfish for yourself?
I try to do something every day. I have a variety of hobbies. I take dance classes. I go out and sit in the woods on my property and just listen to the birds, listen to the wind. I make sure that I do something to replenish myself because I know what I'm like if I don't, and it's really not very pleasant.
Right. And what is your most recent wellness challenge?
I have this bad sugar habit, and I'm trying to decrease the amount of sugar and increase the amount of good things that I put into my body.
What are you talking about? Like sweet tea, or is it like candy?
Scones, cookies, right. So I try not to have them around the house. I try to find alternative sweet things, fruit, these really good fruit frozen pops, those kinds of things. I don't think I could ever totally eliminate sugar from my life, although my health would probably be better for it.
I tell you, it's really hard. Everything has sugar. I mean, I read all the labels and everything for my kids, and my husband actually eliminated sugar from his diet, and it's just really hard.
Right, right. Well, I am vegetarian, most often vegan. And so I give myself a gold star for that. And if I still have sugar to some extent, well, okay, that may have to be something that I just have to live with. Yeah. But, you know, it's a goal.
Yeah, exactly. And tell me about your most recent wellness success.
Oh, I have significantly increased my muscle strength, my agility, my balance. Again, I'm doing NEA dance classes, and I go to a facility where I'm building bone strength, and I feel the difference. I literally recognize the physical changes in my body, and that is just,
That's awesome.
In itself is a great reward. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, and after a certain age, you can't actually grow new bone or, you know, but you can strengthen.
Right, exactly. And, you know, I always thought I had really good balance, but I was proven wrong. And doing what I am currently doing has increased that agility and my ability to balance in all kinds of unsteady conditions tremendously. So, you know, that makes getting older a whole lot more feasible and palatable.
Yeah. Robin, we talked about in the first part of the show about sort of why you're committed to working with women and what you do personally and some of your challenges. And now we're going into the segment that I call Superpowers for Success. So I want to start by asking you, what does success actually mean for you?
Me specifically, it means that I have a good enough business and an awesome life. And a good enough business is my own definition, meaning I don't compare it with anybody else's business, how much money they're making, how many clients they have, those kinds of things. And an awesome life to me means that I am finding joy and fulfillment every day. Now, I get joy and fulfillment from helping my clients, so I get a twofer. You know, I also find my own sources of joy and fulfillment. Success for me is knowing that I am making a difference in the world. It's not going to win me a Nobel Prize, but I am making a difference in other people's lives.
Mm-hmm. And when did you know that you were really good at what you do?
As far as coaching, I knew I was a good mentor, and I was doing mentoring by the seat of my pants. I mean, I wanted to be helpful, but I didn't really have a framework, as I mentioned before. So once I retired from my university job, I decided I would investigate life coaching, and I found out I was really good at it. I am empathic, I'm intuitive, and I know how to motivate women to make changes. Plus, I'm a really good cheerleader. So that is what is driving me onward right now, helping women see that they can have the life that they want. Mm. Not what others tell them it should be, but the life that they want, which may or may not include family, which may or may not include a career, that they get to define life on their terms. And then I help them do that.
Right. Can you describe one personal habit that contributes to your well-being? How do you stay well in order to do all the things you do?
Well, as I mentioned before, I monitor what I eat. I exercise to ensure I've got sufficient energy, all of those things that we read about but sometimes don't do. And I have a passion that drives me, the helping of other women. So I feel fulfillment. I feel that I am making positive changes. And that's one of the things I look forward to when I get out of bed in the morning. I get another day to do what I love doing. Mm-hmm. And I make sure that I have time to do the things that replenish me. So this keeps me energized. And does that mean I don't have bad days? Well, no. Just like here in New Mexico, we do have rain sometimes, but the sun always comes out, and I know why I've been put on this earth, and that keeps me going.
And if you can think back to a time when you discovered that you had a superpower or a strength, something, and you realize you had it, but actually it was there all the time.
Well, as I've said in the earlier segment, I've always been the champion for girls, translated into young women and then into women. And I thought that was just kind of my feeling. And then working at the university and in my coaching business, it's like I suddenly gave myself permission to be who I really am. I want to help other women. Particularly in my coaching business, I have discovered that women very often give away their power, and they usually do it unconsciously. They let others make their decisions. They're concerned about others' opinions. There's a lot of shoulds in their life. And I have learned personally that I know what's best for me, and while I'll listen to other opinions, it doesn't mean I will necessarily follow them. And I try to eliminate the shoulds in my life. I consciously choose to do things.
So you're saying women give away their power every day, all the time, in the decisions and opinions that they have. How? Give us some clear examples of that.
Well, for example, women will put on certain kinds of clothing, and then they'll go to somebody and say, how do I look? Really? Look in the mirror. Do you think you look fine? Great. Go with it.
But what if her opinion of whether she thinks she looks fine hinges upon what someone else thinks? How does she undo that?
I think it comes from believing in yourself, from knowing what you want, and then going after those things, recognizing there will be challenges along the way, but that does not diminish whatever you're trying to achieve. I use the phrase living life on your own terms, which means in a matter of what you wear, this is who I am. My clothing, my jewelry, my whatever express who I am, and being proud of that, not feeling the need to be a clone of your neighbors, your friends, the women you work with. Often women will say yes when they really mean no. That's another way of giving away your power. You're asked, you want to go see this movie? You're thinking, oh, no, man, I don't want to see that. And then you say, yes, you've given away your power to someone else.
Interesting. Yeah. And I find one way that women give away their power a lot is by apologizing right before they say something else. It's almost like they negate anything else they're about to say because they say, sorry, you know, and then they say their thing. And it's like, why are they apologizing? And I mean, we all do it. I do it as well.
Right, right. One of the questions we need to ask ourselves is, are we responsible for what happened? And if not, there's no need to apologize, and we need to keep our mouths closed.
Oh, that's a good one. Are we responsible for what happened?
Yes, yes, right. And the other way that women give away their power is when they're given a compliment. And how often have you heard, oh, well, that's nothing. I got that on sale. Oh, this is so old. We're discounting ourselves by saying that. The appropriate response to a compliment is, why, thank you. Thank you for noticing. Period.
Right. And yeah, period. No, you don't have to explain it. You don't have to explain where you bought it on sale. Right. Yeah.
Exactly.
Oh, we all do that, don't we? But these are good tips. And, you know, just by putting these in place, you can actually feel yourself regain some of that power. It feels right. Good to say those things.
Right. And the interesting thing about regaining your power is it's like a muscle. The more you practice it, the better you get at it, and the more power you get. And so start small and just keep at it. That's my advice to the women I work with.
Lastly, Robin, I just wanted to ask you, in terms of this Superpowers for Success segment, what book would you recommend to our listeners right now? Like, just if you had to pick one book right now for people to read.
To get back their powers?
Yeah.
Well, I will say my own. My book is called Reclaim Your Power, Become Who You Were Meant to Be. And the who you were meant to be is really important. I talk about where you're leaking your power, what that feels like, what would life be like for you if you had your power back in various areas of your life. And then I talk about how you can get there. Hmm. You obviously need someone to share this with, someone who will help hold you accountable, because we hate disappointing other people. And it's a how-to workbook.
Okay, great. And the name of the book, one more time?
Is Reclaim Your Power, Become Who You Were Meant to Be.
Okay. And just lastly, Robin, who has influenced you the most in terms of you reading other people's work? Like, if you had to give our listeners one person to go and read, who would that be?
Brené Brown and Martha Beck are really good examples of saying what you mean, meaning what you say, and doing it kindly and standing up for yourself.
Great. Well, that's a great note to end our conversation on. I am so thrilled that we got to chat this afternoon, Robin. Thank you so much for being on the show.
You're quite welcome.
That's it for our show today. I've been speaking with Robin Anderson, women's empowerment advocate, author, former teacher, and certified professional life coach. I spoke with Robin about putting her needs to the side for others, learning to own her ideas when others tried to claim them, and helping women to replace self-doubt with self-love and power. You can get Robin's Giving Away Your Power handout for free at wellwomanlife.com/015show. Our monthly live event, Well Woman Drinks, brings women together to share our successes and challenges as women leaders, moms, aunts, sisters, and all the other roles we carry. If you'd like to attend a Well Woman Drinks near you, or if there isn't one in your city yet and you'd like to start one, email me at info@wellwomanlife.com. If you enjoyed the show, please take a moment and subscribe in iTunes and leave a review. This really helps raise visibility so that women who haven't heard the show yet can find it. You can also continue the conversation in the Well Woman Life community group at facebook.com/groups/wellwomanlifecommunity. For feedback, comments, or just to let me know you are listening today, find me on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at Well Woman Life. I'm Giovanna Rossi for The Well Woman Show. Until next time, have a super powerful week.